Hello everyone, greetings from PMG Engineering. I'm Shimi Sebastian and in today's video, I shall be giving a brief on hygienic design of food factory. To ensure food safety and sanitization, it is mandatory to have factory constructed with appropriate layout and emphasizing on hygienic engineering parameters, which are in line to customer as well as GFSI best practices. Hygienic food factory design provides food safety by providing barriers to food contamination. In this module for hygienic engineering, we shall be discussing on importance of hygienic food factory and how barrier technology, zoning and facility construction plays an important role in hygienic engineering. No specific answer exists for what benefits hygienic factory design provides, because there is a list that I can make you all count. Hygienic food factory design helps in providing defense against external and internal factory hazards, optimal designing, eliminating any form of possible harborage sites, and gives security against deliberate contamination. This can be achieved by proper check at outside premises level, closing of factory buildings levels, and by segregating the restricted areas. Designing also facilitates proper internal flow of people, product, packaging, air, and waste to prevent any form of physical, chemical, or microbial form of contamination. Barrier technology is employed in hygienic engineering in three stages: barrier in outer premises, barrier in factory building, and barrier for segregation of restricted and processing areas. So in outer premises, we provide barriers to prevent unauthorized access to the facility and to have control and monitoring over transport vehicles, which basically come for raw materials and end products, and also to keep track on personals and domestic and non-domestic animals entry in facility. So in barrier one, there is also listed to have your perimeter approx 3 meters of the factory free from any form of vegetation to avoid pest breeding and harborage site. In the second barrier type, that is barrier in factory building, we consider entrance and exits to be designed for control over personals, raw and finished food products, air, process aids, waste, utilities and pesticide facility. Few other barriers we use inside food factory building are screening and covering floor drains, sewers, ventilator openings, roofs, vents, etc. to prevent any form of entry of rats, insects and birds in the facility. The third barrier is segregation of restricted areas and processing equipment. So each area has different hygienic requirement and controlled access, that is marked during designing. Processing equipments including storage and conveying system must have an adequate hygienic design and must be of close type to protect the food products from external contamination. So now moving forward to zoning. On basis zoning, most basic categorization is basic hygienic zone, medium hygienic zone and high hygienic zone. In basic hygienic zone, there is also three type of categorization, that is zone B, zone B0 and zone B1. Zone B basically have area having basic level of hygienic design, and area encompasses product that are not susceptible to contamination or that are protected in their final packages. Whereas zone B0 has area outside the building wherein the objective is to control or reduce hazards created by unauthorized personals entry and hazards created by water, dirt, dust and presence of animals. Now talking about the zone B1. Zone B1 includes warehouses that store both raw material and packaged processed product. Offices, workshop, power supplies areas, canteen and redundant building or rooms. The objective is to control or reduce hazards created by birds and pests. Now we will be looking into medium hygiene zone. Again, in medium hygiene zone, the area falls in are where only medium level of hygienic design is required, which include process area where products are produced that are susceptible to contamination. But where the consumer group is not especially sensitive and where no further microbial growth is possible in the product. In this area, product might be exposed to environment during sampling and or during the opening of equipment to clean blockage. But the objective is to control or reduce the creation of hazardous sources that can affect an associated area of higher zone classification and protection of the interior of food processing equipment from contamination when exposed to the atmosphere. Now to the high hygiene zone. High hygiene zone, also known as zone H, are areas where the highest level of hygiene is required, which in food processing is equivalent of a clean room and must be completely contained. Zone H is typical for open processing, where even short exposure of product to the atmosphere can result in a food safety hazard. And the objective is to control all product contamination hazard and to protect the interior of food processing equipment from exposure to atmosphere. High hygiene zone has filtered air supplies to this area so that the product doesn't get contaminated. So now talking about lot of individual parameters is involved and when collaborated makes a facility hygienic in nature, like having appropriate layout of facility, having pest prevention, having pest control design, having internal hygienic design, internal piping, flooring, drain, filter, air, and having hygienic lighting. So now we will be looking in on each parameter individually. So first one is having appropriate layout. So having appropriate layout that adapts to hygienic requirements of a given process, packaging, or storage area is a must. The interior of the factory must be designed so that the flow of material, personnel, air, and waste can process in a right direction. Movement of food products, raw materials, and ingredients should move from the dirty to the clean areas, whereas flow of food waste and discarded outer packaging material should be in the opposite direction. To meet a possible increase of processing activity, wherein the food plant in the future, the building and its food processing support system should be designed so they can either be expanded or another building and utilities can be added. The next point is pest prevention. To exclude flooding and the entry of rodents, factory should be built at a higher level than the ground outside with no exterior door opening directly into the production area. And in receiving and dispatch area as well, the number of loading docks should be minimal and be 1 to 1.2 meter above ground levels. And areas beneath docks should not provide harborage for pests by paving and having proper drainage system. To prevent the entry of insects, dock opening should be protected with plastic strips or air curtains. Plastic strips are also known as strip curtains, and external lighting should that is to illuminate factory entrance should be placed in location away from the factory building, which attracts insects. Intruding insects can be attracted and killed within the factory by strategically positioned UV light electric grids or adhesive glue boards. Next parameter is hygienic design construction material. Construction materials for equipment and utility piping should be hygienic, smooth, non-absorbent, non-toxic, and easily cleanable. It should be chemical resistant to product, process chemicals, and cleaning and sanitizing agents. Surfaces that are frequently wet should not be painted as the paint can crack, flake, and chip, with no use of lead, mercury, and cadmium within the factory. In the food contact area, electric components must always be enclosed in junction boxes, casings, closed cable housings, cabinets, etc. or should be installed in non-product contact zone or in technical corridors. In terms of material of constructions that should be avoided in a food factory are zinc, copper, aluminium, bronze, brass, copper, and even galvanized and painted steel, because they have poor resistance to detergents, disinfectants, acidic food and steam, and hence must be avoided in food contact areas. Now is the integration of piping. Utility piping in high hygienic areas should be integrated into wall compartments or the ceilings. If this is not possible, it is recommended to use open racks fixed to the ceiling or walls and columns close to the ceilings. Sufficient clearance must be provided between pipe runs and adjacent surfaces so that both are readily accessible for cleaning and maintenance. The pipe racks must be designed hygienically to minimize the presence of horizontal ledges, crevices or gaps where inaccessible dirt can accumulate. Food processing support pipe should be directly routed from service room to the process area and should always be logical and as simple as possible with minimum amount of utility piping. To remove the condensate, steam traps should be located at all low, convenient points along any extended pipe length. Steam purge for relief of steam condensate in a drain should be intricately connected to that drain. Discharge of condensate from the system should be via an air break to prevent back siphonage. Neither process nor utility pipe should have dead legs. Vertical entrance of piping into the equipment or equipment jacket is more hygienic than horizontal utility piping runs. Running of process and utility piping over open equipment and food preparation area can't be accepted, and nesting of ductwork should be avoided because they call for physical contamination. Piping should be installed at least 6 cm from walls and floor to encourage thorough cleaning around it, and corners should be avoided as it hampers thorough cleaning. Next is penetration of piping through walls, ceilings and floor. So piping that transport dirty fluids should not run in the vicinity of utilities that transport process aids, especially if these process aids are in direct contact with the food to be processed. Basically, food processing support pipe should run unidirectionally with the support piping running from the cleanest area towards the least clean area. Pipeline penetration through walls, ceilings and floor should be minimized, as holes in this area can lead to sanitization problem and can invite the entry of insects and rodent. Opening in floors for pipes should be guarded with sleeve to avoid spill of cleaning solution onto the lower floor. When several pipes penetrate the floor, a larger curb floor can replace several pipe sleeves to improve the cleanability of the surrounding process equipment environments. So that was about piping penetration. Now moving to the flooring. Flooring in a facility should be chemical and wear resistant with proper sloping towards drain and with curved wall floor junctions. Curbs having a 30 degree slope prevents accumulation of water, dust or soil. For warehouse where excellent resistance to heavy traffic is critical, concrete flooring including the high strength granolithic concrete finish are suitable. Untreated concrete can be dusty if dry and highly susceptible to damage from water and acids. When wet, and concrete floor is not recommended for high care production area because it can spall and absorb water and nutrients, allowing microbial growth below the surface. And epoxy coating is recommended for floors. Now the drains. Selection of drain is basis type of cleaning, hygiene level of area and sensitivity of the product. And if talking about the size of the drain pipe, it should have a minimum dia of 100 NB for fluent flow of water. There are two types of drain that are basically used in industry. They are wet type and dry type drainage system. Devices for the evacuation of liquid is basically comprising of grating, basket and siphon. So grating collects liquid and allows to pass, while basket retains larger particles and siphon prevents backflow of aerosol and odor. So as I mentioned, there are two type of drains, that is wet and dry. So in wet basket, in the wet drains, basket must retain more than 3 mm particles, that is particle having larger size than 3 mm, and extra gating must be used if there are larger number of particles being being processed in the processing unit. Siphons maintain full of water, that I have just mentioned, that it prevents the backflow of aerosol and odor as it maintains full of water. Drain layout and sloping work should be installed before civil work and designed in a manner that no crossing of drainage from high hygiene area to low hygiene area, as any blockage in low or medium hygiene area will lead to flooding of drain in high hygiene and will be reason of contamination. So drains with infrequent usage should be capped with when not in used. Now the dry type drains. It is basically the main factor, important factor that should be kept in mind, is that it should not act as a air duct from low to high hygiene area, and it should render air locks. It generally remains totally dry when not in use, and while designing dry drains, it is very important to ask a question: is a drain really necessary at this place? And if yes, how few needs to be installed? So installation of drains should be carefully planned to avoid ponding of water and to prevent contamination in area. The drain bodies must be free of pockets that can hold food soil, otherwise they will be causing problems like odor. Only drains with internal P-traps and atmospheric breaks should be used, as P-traps create a water lock that helps sewer gas out of the plant. So balanced air supply and exhaust system is also an important component for hygienic designing. Exhaust system should have a sufficient capacity to remove excess heat, dust, vapor, aerosol, odor and bioburden from process rooms. The supply of filter air in the room by HVAC system must be large enough, otherwise the exhaust system will attempt to draw the required amount of air from adjacent less clean areas through doorways and windows. Exhaust fan must be located outside the building to maintain a negative pressure in the portion of the duct system located within the building. If they are installed in an exhaust tube, the exhaust air is pushed through the duct and not pulled out. By pushing vapors, fume, etc. through that duct, the system puts the exhaust duct under positive pressure, which can force dirty air back into the room through holes and gaps in the ductwork. Now is hygienically designed lighting. So lighting must illuminate horizontal and vertical working surfaces evenly, without causing glare, and at an intensity of about 300 to 500 lux at normal working height. Walls and ceiling should be light colored, because that permits fast detection of dirt and soil on the surface, while in contrast, dark colored walls and floors require additional lighting. Preference should be given to lighting mounted on ceilings rather than on the walls, because process equipment, storage racks, etc. can form shadows that can make cleaning and inspection of floor, walls or ceiling difficult. And for the same reason, overhead piping should not obstruct lighting. And selected lighting should produce little heat and UV light to prevent attraction of insects and to avoid projections, and we should avoid any form of projections that basically accumulate dust that can build into the ceiling or wall with a hermetically closed seal. So to conclude, I would like to add that integration of hygienic and sanitary design, that were discussed during this module when followed in real time for construction of food and beverage manufacturing units, it will help in minimizing contamination risk and enable effective cleaning and sanitization. So this brings us to the end of this presentation. Thank you all and have a good day.